Hello, Kendal. Are you having a festival so far? So mine's great fun. Welcome to the Berghaus Women and Adventure Session. I'm your host for the evening. My name is Lee Craigie. I am the co-director of an organisation called the Adventure Syndicate, a collective of women who ride their bikes very long distances, but then they tell stories about it. We make films, we deliver podcasts, and the idea is to show us as human beings, to be relatable, to be humble and human, no matter what our story is, to show our vulnerabilities as well as our strengths, and to show the power of community, collaboration and care in the outdoors, a message that sometimes gets lost. Hetty Key recently conducted a study of women in adventure. She asked 3,000 women what changes they would like to see in this, our outdoor world, Kendal Film Festival, the media, out there on the hill. It was really interesting what came back from that. Let me share that with you. She found six things, these women, they said six things they wanted. They wanted to see less competition, less about the timings and just more about the participation. They wanted to see real people represented, a diverse amount of people, diverse groups of people. They wanted mental well-being to be prominent over physical well-being. They wanted to see less adrenaline, like full-on adrenaline sports, and acceptance of participation on all levels. They wanted more storytelling, but stories of normal people that they could relate to. And they wanted a balance. They wanted it to be real. You know, a lot of people have to balance work life and family. They wanted all of that. And when I read that, I was like, well don't we all? Surely that's what we all want in our outdoor community. So then, begs question, why are women in Adventure Session? And that's because we're not there yet. We're not quite there yet. Although outdoor activity is on the rise, there's still a massive gap between women participating and men participating. Until that's closed, I think there's real power in female-only spaces. So it's still relevant, but maybe, I don't know, one day we'll have just the people in Adventure Session, who knows, and we'll all embody all of those things. So, we have tonight for you the most humble, human and inspiring of presentations. In January 2018, six women endured 61 days in temperatures as low as 40 degrees centigrade to cross Antarctica. Please join me in a big, warm Kendal welcome to the Ice Maidens.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Nix Wetherill. I am a doctor in the army, in the British Army, and I was the expedition leader for this, for Antarctica Ice Maiden. I'm just going to let the rest of the team introduce themselves and I'm going to tell you a little bit more about it.
Hi, I'm Jen Stevenson. I'm 30 and I'm from Newcastle. And I'm currently serving captain in the Royal Artillery in the British Army. Jen's also just failed to mention that she recently, well, she's not that quite long ago now, passed the All Arms Commando course, so she now actually serves alongside the Marines, so she's pretty cool. I am Zana Baker. I am in the process of actually leaving the army. I've been a regional advisor for Somalia for a short period of time, and I'm now looking at developing travel to regions that we don't really understand. So perhaps you might come visit these places with me.
Hi, I'm Sandy. I'm the oldest member of the team. Get that in there before someone says something. I joined the army at 18, straight from school, and was a soldier for about 6 years before getting the chance to commission. And I'm now in the Army Reserves. I left the regulars and I do it part-time. And I've been working, leading expeditions with school groups and that sort of thing before starting my own business now.
Good evening. My name's Rin and I'm an Army Reservist medic. And I have the pleasure of being the team nutritionist for the Ice Maidens.
Hi, I'm Sophie Montagna. I'm the second oldest on the team, actually the one with the least military experience. I was an army reservist, but I've never served with the regular army, so I felt myself a little bit behind in terms of the experience of the rest of the team. Now I work with Sandy, we've set up our own business, and we now talk to people about our experiences of teamwork in Antarctica.
So that's the team. But now to hear a bit about the trip. And I first want to say that I can't believe we were just sitting up here chatting and seeing everybody filing in, and it was suddenly dawned on us that we're here at the Kendal Mountain Festival, suddenly talking, and we had no idea that we would. You know, when we started this whole journey 10 years ago, or certainly I started this journey 10 years ago, I did not expect to be here. So thank you very much for welcoming us here. So 10 years ago, I first had this idea to cross Antarctica. And it actually came to me from, I'd gone to listen to somebody talking about their crossing of Antarctica. And I was so inspired by what this person said. I was literally hanging on every word. And I knew I wasn't going to be happy just listening to him. I wanted to experience it myself. So I went up to him at the end of the talk and I said, have you got any tips on how I can get involved in something like this? And he said, well, I was in the right place at the right time. And I was like, that's not a great tip. But it did make me realise that actually if I did really want to do something like this, I would have to create that opportunity myself. So fast forward a few years, I had joined the army, I was now a doctor, and I'm a very, very hardworking doctor, but I do like to get out of the office or hospital as much as possible. And in the army, we are offered adventurous training opportunities where we can go and do mountaineering, skiing, climbing, kayaking, all these activities, all for free, and we get trained. And I took up as many opportunities to go and get out of the hospital and do these adventurous training courses. And it was on these courses that I realised that I was often the only female amongst dozens of men. Now, we know the military is kind of a male-dominated environment, and we don't try to change that, but it wasn't a true ratio of the number of women that were on the rest of these courses. And that was what gave me my second idea. It was to get more women within the army to push themselves physically and mentally and take up these adventurous training opportunities, and everything that just going outside and going and being adventurous, all the opportunities and benefits it gives to you. It was never about proving to men what women could do. It was actually about proving to women what women could do. So that's where I now had that second idea, to take an all-female team across Antarctica. So I'm just gonna tell you about building the team. So now I had this idea, and I wanted to not focus on that final team of six. We wanted it to be a team of six, but I knew that, you know, I could pick six people and we could cross Antarctica. It was about giving as many people an opportunity to get something out of it as possible. And so we opened it up to the whole of the army, and we had over 250 women apply. So that was a record breaking of the number of applications for an expedition. And through 2 years, we whittled the numbers down, giving everybody an opportunity to try skiing for the first time, to meet like-minded people, to get outside and see the benefits that just being outside and pushing yourself can really give to you, but even back in the office as well. And over that 2 years, the things that we were looking for to build our team were people who just kept pushing themselves, who never gave up. People who were prepared to commit 2 years of their life to possibly not even being on that final team. Some people here moved back in with their parents. That to me shows a lot of commitment. But the most important thing was that we were looking for people who put the team as a whole first. And that, I think, for anyone that has been a part of a team, you'll realise that just realising that you are very much a part of that team is the most important thing for success as a team. And over 2 years, this is what we were training for. This is our journey across Antarctica. It's 1,700 kilometres. It's quite difficult to imagine how far that is. So I have just overlaid the USA on top. And that's how far we were travelling. We had to carry all our kit and equipment. And as you can imagine, we had done so much training for this, it was a very, very exciting but scary time. You know, none of us had ever been to the Antarctic before. None of us had been on a huge expedition like this. We were essentially novices taking on what was actually a huge challenge. And some of the challenges that we had to face were, you know, we expected some of them. So, you know, we expected cold. The coldest on average was about minus 30. The coldest it ever got to was minus 56. And, you know, of course, everything freezes when it's cold. As you can see, you've got modelling what we call the snotsicle. And that was essentially where, because it was so cold, every time you breathed out, the moisture on your breath would freeze and it would collect on the bottom of this piece of material. Now, we are prepared for the challenge of it being cold, but some of the small things that we just hadn't really prepared for was actually hidden underneath this, the claustrophobia. Underneath this snotsicle, you've got your zip pulled all the way up to your neck, and there's a metal zip, and every time you breathe out, that ice is collecting around that metal. At the end of the day, the first thing you want to do is take off this really claustrophobic jacket and quite limited vision, and you can't because you are literally frozen into it. And it was something that we just hadn't even considered because we hadn't come across that in all our training. But luckily, we had done a lot of psychological work, and it was then that we really relied on those coping strategies that we had worked together as a team, so that it wasn't the straw that broke the camel's back. We could actually get past that, take a deep breath, and move on from being stuck literally in our jackets. So it's those things that really taught us, and we've brought back to our jobs nowadays, that actually coping strategies that you learn in the outdoor environment is so important back in the office as well. This is Sandy's pair of socks, and it was actually just appreciating the small things that we take for granted back here. Having a wash every day, or changing your socks every day. We didn't change our underwear or our socks or anything for 30 days. Yeah, it was pretty gross, we smelt really bad. But again, it was those challenges that we overcame and we learned to push ourselves and to accept and to appreciate. Now that we're back, we really appreciate a shower, just running water. So, you know, those are things that we face in Antarctica. Other challenges. Oh, there's no sound. I'll make the sound for you. This was our second day, and we again had expected some bad weather, but we had this was our second day, and we'd only accomplished 16 kilometres, and suddenly we were faced with this big storm, and this was probably my biggest challenge, because I had to basically make sure that everybody was safe, and I remember everybody looking at me, being scared, and saying, "Well, you've got to make the decision." And I had to decide whether to risk our life-saving equipment being shredded to pieces or whether to carry on and hope the short-lived katabatic wind would pass through. But luckily, I went for the safety option and we put up a tent, and it takes teamwork when you can't see each other, when you can't hear each other, and you're suddenly trying to put up a tent in such strong winds. But we were successful, we all clambered in, and there was nothing else to do but sing along to Frozen. The South Pole, this was, as you can imagine, this is what we had been aiming for, is this this turning point in our map, and from here we were going home. We'd kind of forgotten that actually it was only a third of the journey through, and we were all very happy when we arrived at the South Pole, but even more happy when we were leaving, because we were going home and we knew we were going to finally finish it. But then the boredom set in, and that's when team conflict and all the challenges just re-arose. And these were over 61 days. It's a long time to be with just five other people, as much as I love them. It's really a long time to be with just five other people and no other input, no other stimulus or anything. And that's where there were times which we had to identify, when this team conflict was becoming an issue. And this is us on one of our breaks. So we would ski for 10 hours a day for 1 hour, 15 minutes at a time. And this is on our breaks, and 8 minutes, you had 8 minutes to basically eat as much as you possibly could, prioritize whatever you needed to do. And I remember distinctly one day, one of the girls here was shouting at me. I couldn't hear what she was saying, but she was shouting at me. And I was thinking, what have I done? And then it was suddenly time to go. We packed up and I set off. And I, the whole of that leg, I was going round and round in my head. What have I done? Why was she shouting at me? And then I didn't have an opportunity to speak to her at the next break. And it wasn't until the end of the day. By now, she hated me. She was never going to talk to me again. And it wasn't until that evening when we had our team meeting, which we had every night. And I said to her, why did you shout at me in break three? And she said, oh, I didn't think you could hear me, but I was offering you some chocolate. And the amount of emotional energy wasted, and I think we can all reflect on that, in that, you know, we do that with emails and text messages, is we put our own interpretation on it. So again, that's a massive lesson for all of us, is misinterpretation. It's completely understandable that, you know, some of these team conflicts were coming to a head, because we were approaching at the end of our trip the most dangerous part, and these are crevasses, and I'm sure everybody here knows what a crevasse is. And down in Antarctica, they are huge, and we did not want to fall down them. So of course, what are you going to do to protect yourself from falling down them is to train over and over and over again, falling down a crevasse. I'm just going to say, the crevasses are even harder to spot when you're in conditions like this. So imagine every step that you're taking could be the next step. And this was a brilliant opportunity to not only learn how we were going to pull each other out of the crevasse and make sure it's literally muscle memory, but also to see how each of us coped under such difficult situations, and literally our lives were in each other's hands, and we had to trust each other. And that was a huge part of our team, is trust. Luckily though, we didn't fall down any crevasses, and it was 61 days, but we have rounded that up. It was actually 60 days, 15 hours and 45 minutes that we've been skiing. And this is us at the finish line, and I love this photo because it shows that we had been through a lot and we had accepted it, and we were still very much a team. And we look back now, and actually we broke three records while we were, in fact four records, I'm going to mention the fourth one here, four records. So the first was the only one that was gender specific. We were the first all-female team to cross Antarctica using muscle power alone, and that was the one we had hoped to break. But subsequently, we found out later that we'd actually broken three others, and that was that we were the largest team to have ever crossed Antarctica, that we had the youngest person ever to have crossed Antarctica, that's Jen here. So if anyone here is younger than 28, you can beat her. the one that we're most proud of was that we were the first team to have crossed Antarctica with not one of us having been to the Antarctic or the Arctic before. So essentially complete novices. And I think that just shows that you really do need that time, training, commitment, and teamwork to make this an accomplishment. That's a very generic flavour, quick flavour of what Antarctica to us is. But I am going to finish with a short video which summarises even more the whole journey, and hope to give you a better flavour of the trip.
When all is lost and hope is gone, when life is frail and hearts are weak, show our strength and dignity to dream a dream of victory, to feel the fight that drives us on. Bring
Hi, thanks so much for sharing that. I bet there's a million questions in the audience, but you're going to have to find them in the bar afterwards, which I'm sure that's where you're going to be, isn't it? I think we should add a fifth record to that, though, the longest time spent in the same pair of pants. That's impressive, 30 days. Yeah. Thanks so much. A big round of applause for Ice Maidens.